It is crazy how easy it has become to produce your own solar power at home. I mean, you simply grab yourself two big solar panels, throw them in the sun, connect their wires to a microinverter, and then push its power wire into an existing outlet. And bam, I'm producing 500 watts of free power for my home. Such setups are called Balkonkraftwerk here in Germany, which translates to balcony power plant. And the great thing about them is that you can install them and use them even if you have no idea how electricity works. That comes with a price though, because the max rated output power of the inverter is limited to 600 watts, which is still enough though to comfortably power my whole workshop. So everything is fine, right? Well, the problem is that when you don't use your generated solar power, then it simply goes into the power grid without you receiving any money for it. And I think that just sucks. So in this video, I will try to build the ultimate balcony power plant system that, with its big battery pack, will hopefully not let any power escape to the power grid. And spoiler warning, while I did achieve the end result I was looking for, some parts of this project really broke my spirit. So let's not waste any more time and let's get started. This video is sponsored by Victron Energy, who provided all the main components for this project. And trust me, I looked at other manufacturers as well to find suitable components that could enhance my balcony power plant. But pretty much only Victron Energy offers such a big variety of components that makes it possible to more or less easily create such an energy storage system. So definitely check them out if this video got you curious. Now first off, I think the ground is not the best place for my two solar panels, considering that my roof still offers lots of space. So I got myself such a mounting kit consisting of roof hooks, big screws, aluminium bars, clamps, and some other smaller parts. The idea is that you mount these hooks under your roof tiles, and as soon as you got enough of them, you can secure two aluminium bars on them, onto which you can then lay the solar panels that get tightened down with the clamps. Pretty simple stuff in theory, but practically speaking, this task was super hard for me to do, since I never did something like this before, and my roof also comes with an incline of 45 degrees, which is pretty steep. So, as a disclaimer, let me tell you that working on such a roof, as well as doing mains voltage wiring like I will do later, should only be done by professionals. So please, use this video more as an inspiration than a step-by-step DIY guide. With that being said, I continued placing my roof hooks and marking these spots on the roof tiles where I have to grind away some material, so that the hooks can later fit through. And here I already did one big mistake, and that was removing material from the tiles that were underneath the hooks, because they were too close to one another. Thankfully though, I had some spare tiles laying around, so a replacement took place before I created the solution to this problem, which were simple square pieces of wood that I could place underneath the hooks to act as spacers. With those, it was pretty simple to finish all six roof hooks, and I think I don't have to say much about adding the aluminium bars, because that was pretty self-explanatory. So the next step was then adding the microinverter to one bar. And at this point, we have to think about how to connect the inverter to mains power, since there was no socket nearby. To do that, there was luckily an empty conduit going from my main distribution board to my attic, through which I pushed two very important cables. One of them was a thick green-yellow PE wire, aka protective earth wire, that will connect to the metal mount and solar panels on the roof and my house's earth, for safety reasons. And then we got the main power wire, that connects directly to the inverter and mains voltage in my distribution board. But before getting to that, I of course had to guide the wire through my attic, add a surge protection device along the way once again for safety reasons, and then push the wires down my roof so that I can grab them near the solar panel mounting system. And after then adding the required connector to the main power wire and connecting that to the inverter, it was finally time to play around in my house's distribution board to add a circuit breaker for the inverter to get it powered. But that was not the only thing I added. I also added two EM540 energy meters to my system. One of them monitors how much power goes from the grid to my house, and the other one monitors how much power currently gets generated by my solar panels. And having them is crucial, because otherwise my future energy storage system, or ESS for short, will not be able to know when I have excess solar power that can be used to charge my energy storage, aka batteries. Okay, and with the energy meters installed and nothing blowing up during the first test, it was time to close everything up and finally get the solar panels on the roof. And sadly, that was the moment my spirit got broken, because no matter what we tried, we were not able to get these panels up there. And what you're seeing here right now is the footage of my camera that fell from the roof during this attempt. So I will have to find a professional to get my panels up there. But don't worry, for now I can use some extension cables in combination with a variable lab bench power supply to basically simulate a solar panel. And as you can see, this works perfectly fine. And this brings us to our energy storage system, for which I want to use these four 12-volt LiFePO4 batteries as the energy storage, that basically gets charged up if there's excess solar power, and whose energy can then be used and fed into my home power if there's no solar power. The only device I could find that could do this is such a MultiPlus 2, but in order to get this power electronics beast to function correctly, I also needed a Servo GX for the communication between all parts, a GX Touch to see the user interface and easily change settings, a smart shunt to keep track of the battery voltage and how much current is flowing from and to the battery, and finally two Zigbee wireless transmitters and one receiver, which are mandatory because my energy meters are in the house and my ESS system will be in the garage. And for better understanding, here is my final wiring diagram, meaning it was time to seriously start this build by firstly charging up the batteries. Since each one comes with a capacity of 100 amp hours and I'm charging with only 10 amps, that will take a while. So in the meantime, I positioned all the required components on my garage wall, marked the mounting holes, drilled them, added wall anchors, and finally secured the components in place with screws. As soon as everything was in place, I switched over to my main distribution board, where I had to add an additional power supply and data cables to my energy meters, which I then guided and connected to the two required Zigbee transmitters. At this point, my batteries were finally charged up and came with a similar voltage reading, meaning it was time to place them next to one another on the ground and connect them in series in order to create a 48-volt battery pack. To do that, I got myself this super thick 35 square millimeter red and black wire, which I cut to size and added cable lugs to its ends to create some heavy-duty connection wires. I did this until all connections were done. And just like that, I got my final battery pack, to which I next added the smart shunt. And to keep the wiring a bit tidy along the way, I also added a big cable duct that I immediately used to connect all components to one another with their data cables. Last but not least, I then added the power cables to all components, as well as a big 100 amp fuse for the battery. And finally hooked up the MultiPlus 2 to mains voltage through an additional circuit breaker for safety. And there you go, the prototype of my energy storage system that apparently was wired up correctly, because nothing blew up along the way. And as you can see, mine already displays correct values and has the main functionality all set up. But in order to get to this point, I had to configure quite a few things in the software, which should probably not be done by a complete beginner. But anyway, my battery is charged up to 100%, and here in the settings, I can now configure it to be used as a 600 watt power source like my solar panels. And as you can see, this works perfectly fine. And right now, I'm only drawing around 50 watt from the grid, while the loads in my house draw around 300 watts. By the way, I set this 50 watt value by myself, because if you go down to 0 watts, then it can happen that you feed back into the grid by a tiny amount, and we do not want that. And if we now simulate my solar inverter, which sadly can only output 180 watts, then you can see that when my house load is small enough, then the inverter covers that load and uses the excess to charge the battery pack. Perfect. So all in all, I'm super happy with this project. I just need more solar panels. But some of you might be asking now whether all of this makes financial sense. And the simple answer here is no, not yet. You see, my solar power inputs is way too small for my batteries, meaning they will be underutilized. But the great thing is that such a system is easily extendable and customizable, making it more cost effective. And let's not forget that if you live off grid, then maybe such a system is the only solution to getting mains power. And that can be priceless. Okay, I think you get what I mean. And the last thing I want to say here is that if you want to create such a system yourself, then always check back with your local grid provider, because they have to approve this all. With that being said, I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something new. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.